Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 19th of September 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the respective page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, Hyderabad and Trivandrum editions, the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. Let us see an editorial about polio. This editorial speaks about the successful strategy of the government of Nigeria in eradicating the wild polio virus in Nigeria. And this editorial also speaks about the prevalence of polio virus in countries like Afghanistan and Pakistan. So this editorial generally speaks about polio. So before seeing the editorial, first we shall be seeing about polio. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Now let us see about polio. Polio is also called as poliomyelitis, and polio is caused by a virus which is called as poliovirus. This poliovirus is a member virus of enterovirus C, and these group of viruses belong to the family of picornaviridae. This polio is a highly infectious viral disease. This virus has the capability to invade the central nervous system of human body, and within a matter of hours, it will cause irreversible paralysis. To be very specific, these viruses multiply in the nervous system of human body, and these viruses will destroy the nerve cells which activates the skeletal muscles. So the affected muscles lose their function once the virus attacks the central nervous system. So this condition is called as acute flaccid paralysis. So paralysis means the loss of muscle function in any part of your body. So throughout your body you have muscles, and if your muscles are not able to function properly, then we call it as paralysis. Next, let us see the transmission route of this poliovirus. Usually poliovirus is transmitted from one person to another through oral contact or through the fecal contact. That is, when we tell oral contact, it may be through the saliva or the secretions. And the fecal contact is nothing but the fecal material which will transmit the virus to a healthy person. So usually the transmission of virus happens from the infected person to the healthy person, and it either takes the fecal route or the oral route. Sometimes the virus can also be transmitted through contaminated food or water. So majority of the cases happen through the fecal oral route, and this contaminated food or water route is less frequent as per the World Health Organization. See, there are three types of wild polioviruses. One is type 1, the other is type 2, and the third one is type 3. The World Health Organization tells that in the year 2015, the type 2 wild poliovirus was officially declared as eradicated. And the type 3 wild poliovirus has not been detected since November 2012. So the World Health Organization is telling that the type 1 wild poliovirus is probably the only wild poliovirus type that remains in circulation throughout the world. So we have seen wild poliovirus. Wild poliovirus is nothing but the naturally occurring non-mutated strain of a virus. So all those naturally occurring virus is called as wild poliovirus. Now let us see the symptoms of polio. One thing which we saw was a person who is attacked by polio will have irreversible paralysis. Most infected people, that is around 90% of people, either show no symptoms or they show very mild symptoms. And usually these symptoms go unrecognized before the polio attacks the nervous system. In few cases, the initial symptoms include fever, fatigue, headache, vomiting, then stiffness in the neck and also pain in the limbs. So till date, there is no cure if a person is affected by polio, but we can go for the vaccination route, that is the immunization route, which is the best way of protecting and controlling the spread of polio. As of now, there are two types of vaccine to protect against polio. One is the inactivated polio vaccine, in short IPV, and the second is the commonly used oral polio vaccine. So when we tell inactivated, it means the wild type poliovirus strains are killed with a substance, in this case it is formalin. So this IPV vaccine, the inactivated polio vaccine, is produced from a wild type poliovirus strain that has been inactivated or killed with formalin. And this IPV is given as injection in the leg or arm of the human beings, depending on the age of the human being. Next is the commonly used oral polio vaccine. This consists of a mixture of live attenuated poliovirus strains of all the three poliovirus types, that is type 1, type 2 and type 3. Here attenuated means weakened poliovirus. In India, oral polio vaccine is commonly administered by the government to the children. So we saw that oral polio vaccine consists of a mixture of live weakened poliovirus strains. But there is actually a problem here. The normal function of this oral polio vaccine is that the weakened vaccine virus will replicate in the intestine for a limited period. So immunity will be developed and it will cause a human being to stay immune to polio. But during this time, the vaccine virus is also excreted from the human body. And this excreta can spread to the immediate community if there is inadequate sanitation in a particular community. So even before this weakened vaccine virus dies out, there are chances that this weakened vaccine virus can spread to any human being, because we saw that one of the transmission route is the fecal route. So on rare occasions, if a population is seriously under immunized, then an excreted vaccine virus can continue to circulate for an extended period of time. And the longer it is allowed to survive, the more genetic changes that particular virus will undergo. And in very rare instances, the vaccine virus can genetically change into a form that can paralyze the humans. So this is what is known as circulating vaccine-derived poliovirus, because the weakened virus genetically changes itself into a form that can paralyze the human beings. So this is what we call it as circulating vaccine-derived poliovirus. And there are certain countries which are affected by this kind of poliovirus as well. Now let us see the initiatives taken by the government of India in eliminating polio in India. See, pulse polio immunization scheme was introduced in India in the year 1995, because in the late 1980s and early 90s, India had a huge polio burden. So under this program, all the children below the age of 5 years were administered 2 doses of the oral polio vaccine per year. So the main aim of this pulse polio immunization program is to eliminate poliomyelitis, that is polio, in India by vaccinating all the children under the age of 5 years against the poliovirus. And this pulse polio program was in line with the Global Polio Eradication Initiative. See, this initiative was created in 1988 and it is a public-private initiative, that is the Indian government, with 5 core partners: the World Health Organization, the United Nations Children's Fund, then Rotary International, then the US Center for Disease Control and Prevention, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And due to the sustained efforts taken by the Indian government, the World Health Organization declared India as a polio-free country in the year 2014. So remember this. Know that vaccination for polio is given as per the national immunization schedule by the government of India. So at age, the first oral polio vaccine will be given after the birth. Then 3 doses of oral polio vaccine is given, one at 6th week, the next at the 10th week, and the third at the 14th week from the birth of a child. And when the child is of an age between 16 to 24 months, then the oral polio vaccine booster dose is administered to that child. So this is the vaccination schedule for oral polio vaccine as per the national immunization schedule by the government of India. This is all about polio that you need to know from examination point of view. Now let us see the editorial. This editorial is telling that Nigeria's war against wild poliovirus has approached a climax. That is, Nigeria is close to be declared polio free by 2020, that is by the next year. The editorial tells that in the month of August 2019, Nigeria has reached an important milestone in eradicating polio. It has successfully completed 3 successive years without any single case of wild poliovirus. See, as per World Health Organization, a country is said to have eradicated polio when there is no fresh case of wild poliovirus, which is reported for 3 successive years. So back to back, for 3 years, Nigeria has not even had even a single case of wild poliovirus, that is a fresh case of wild poliovirus. The author is telling that the last case of type 1 wild poliovirus in Nigeria was reported in the month of August 2016. And it has been 3 years since any fresh case of wild poliovirus has been reported in Nigeria. So as per WHO norms, Nigeria might be declared that it is polio free by next year. See, in the year 2015, the World Health Organization removed Nigeria from the list of polio endemic countries. But again in the year 2016, 3 fresh cases were reported in Nigeria. So if cases have been reported, then it means that the wild virus strain was still present in the environment. The editorial is telling that this particular strain was linked to the virus which was detected in Borno, which is a region in Nigeria, in the year 2011. Because Boko Haram insurgency is very much common in the country of Nigeria. Because of the insurgent activities which happened in Borno, the healthcare workers were not able to access almost 60% of the human settlements in that particular province. So the author is telling that almost 5 lakh children in Borno were deprived of healthcare services by the year 2016. So the author is telling that the recurrence of polio in Borno is not a surprise. But the country of Nigeria followed a very unique strategy. The Nigerian government relied on its security forces, that is the military personnel, to escort the healthcare workers to the insurgency hit areas, because only the military personnel had access to the insurgency hit areas. Apart from this, the Nigerian military personnel were also trained as vaccinators, that is those persons who can administer vaccines. So in certain areas, the military personnel themselves vaccinated the children. That is why we are telling it as a unique strategy. So using this strategy, Nigeria was able to vaccinate around 80% of the children with the help of healthcare workers, and the military personnel by themselves were able to vaccinate 26% of the children. So somehow Nigeria was able to contain the transmission of polio. But there are still around 60,000 children who are yet to be vaccinated in the insurgency hit areas. So the true status of the wild polio virus in these children who are in these insurgent hit areas remains unknown. Also in the month of August 2019, the weakened type 2 virus, which was used in oral polio vaccine, turned virulent or toxic. And because of this, there were 16 cases of paralysis reported in Nigeria. If you remember, during our discussion about polio, we were discussing about vaccine-derived poliovirus, where the weakened strains of poliovirus can become active and again cause polio in humans. So this is one classic example for that. But this case will not be considered by the World Health Organization to declare Nigeria as polio-free. Because for World Health Organization, the only criteria is that a country can be declared polio-free if there are no fresh cases of wild poliovirus attacks for successive 3 years. But anyway, the author is trying to emphasize the fact that multiple outbreaks of vaccine-derived polio cases are of great concern. Apart from this, the author of the editorial has also discussed about the case of polio in countries of Afghanistan and Pakistan. The author is telling that when compared to 2018, the number of cases of wild poliovirus has reduced in Afghanistan, but it has increased multifold in Pakistan. So we can see that there is prevalence of poliovirus, that is, there is presence of poliovirus in both these countries. So it can be a threat to the entire global community. The author is telling that at present, poliovirus is endemic in Afghanistan and Pakistan. We saw that Nigeria has almost eliminated polio. That is, it has eradicated wild poliovirus. So it will be declared polio-free by next year by the World Health Organization. So only Afghanistan and Pakistan are left out. Here the term endemic means which is always present in a certain population or a geographic area. And when we tell endemic disease, it means a disease that is always present in a certain population or geographic area. So we can see that there is a presence of poliovirus in Afghanistan and Pakistan. And because of this, it will continue to act as a threat to the children who are living all over the world. The reason is because there is a chance that polio might be transmitted from these countries to other nations, especially by the travelers. It can be refugees, it can be immigrants, it can even be tourists who tour Afghanistan or Pakistan. So they are likely to act as transmitters if they are not properly vaccinated. Because we saw that polio is mainly transmitted from humans to humans. So we are calling this as importation of polio. In this editorial, it is mentioned that in the year 2007, polio importation from Pakistan to Australia was reported. So importation of polio is always possible from Afghanistan or Pakistan to any nation of the world. So polio has to be eradicated in both Afghanistan and Pakistan. So this is all about this editorial. So from this editorial, we have seen what is meant by polio in detail from examination point of view, and how Nigeria has taken certain steps to eradicate polio in its country and how countries like Afghanistan and Pakistan need to eradicate polio in their country. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article states that the Union Cabinet approves the ban on e-cigarettes. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Now let us see the news article. First, we'll be seeing what is meant by e-cigarettes. Then we will see what are the reasons behind the move of the central government to bring an ordinance for the prohibition of e-cigarettes. And then we will see some steps that has been taken so far by the government to deal with this problem. And then we will also see how e-cigarettes hinder attaining important health targets of India. And finally, we'll be seeing the scientific opinions about e-cigarettes. Now, the news is that the Union Cabinet has approved for the promulgation of an ordinance by the President of India. This ordinance is to prohibit various aspects that is related to e-cigarettes or electronic cigarettes. The ordinance will prohibit the production of e-cigarettes, then their manufacture, then their import, export, transport, then their sale, distribution, storage, and also their advertisement. That is why the ordinance will be titled as Prohibition of Electronic Cigarettes, Production, Manufacture, Import, Export, Transport, Sale, Distribution, Storage, and Advertisement Ordinance 2019. Now, the import has to be banned, as the news article mentions that e-cigarettes come from China and there is an American-based company which is trying so hard to enter India to sell vaping devices and e-cigarettes. So once this ordinance comes into enforcement, any person who violates the ordinance can be arrested without warrant, as the violations constitute cognizable offenses. The news article mentions that the sub-inspector has been designated as the authorized officer for the enforcement of this ordinance. So now let us see what is meant by e-cigarettes or the electronic cigarettes. We will see the definition that has been given by the Indian Council of Medical Research, in short ICMR, tells that these e-cigarettes are also called as electronic nicotine delivery systems. They are battery powered devices that are used to smoke or vape. These devices will have a flavored solution which contains a varying concentration of nicotine. So this nicotine is an addictive chemical which is found in cigarettes and also in certain other forms of tobacco products. That is the reason why nicotine is also being used in flavored solutions in the e-cigarettes in order to smoke or vape. Now let us see the reasons why the cabinet has approved for an ordinance to prohibit these e-cigarettes. See, the nicotine that is present in these devices are highly addictive. Now in the definition we saw that nicotine is a highly addictive chemical. Addictive means once you use it, you cannot stop it using again. You will have that urge or feeling to use that particular substance again and again, like how you eat a chocolate or some sweet. Once you're liking that sweet, then you're addicted to that sweet and you keep eating that sweet again and again. So that is the meaning of this term, addictive. So this nicotine usage makes a person addictive. Apart from this, this nicotine also has several health hazards. There is an increased risk of cardiovascular disorders, then respiratory disorders, and also certain neurological disorders. Apart from this, the human body's immune response will also come down. There will be negative impacts on the reproductive health of an individual as well. So it will have impacts on the fetal development and pregnancy in women, especially when they are used to consuming nicotine based products. Then the usage of nicotine will also affect the cell proliferation and some of the other natural human processes. Ultimately, this will lead to cancer. So if a person is addicted to such a chemical, it is injurious to his or her health. This is one of the reasons why the cabinet has approved for the promulgation of this ordinance. Also know that these devices can be used for the use of other psychoactive substances. These psychoactive substances are also called as psychotropic substances or psychotropic drugs. See, these drugs are natural or chemical substances that act primarily upon the central nervous system of the human body. Here, it will alter the brain function and it will affect the mental process of a human being. So these drugs are prohibited in India and it is regulated severely by the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act of 1985. So we saw that these substances are extremely harmful to the human health. Now, the problem with electronic cigarettes or the e-cigarettes is that these battery-powered devices can also be utilized for the use of psychotropic drugs. This is one of the reasons. Another reason is that it is found by many researchers that after the introduction of e-cigarettes, many non-smokers have become addicted to these e-cigarettes and they have started using these e-cigarettes. The pressing concern here is that the young children, adolescents and youth are becoming victims of these devices. They have been addicted, and whatever be the de-addiction methods, it is found that such children are very difficult to be treated and they become victims to these e-cigarettes. So this will hamper or affect their daily activities and they will not be able to develop to their fullest potential. If you see, these electronic cigarettes are advertised as less harmful products when compared to the conventional cigarettes, that is the normal cigarettes which you can see throughout the country. But the scientific studies have found that many persons who have started using e-cigarettes have ended up using conventional cigarettes as well. So it is like e-cigarette is acting as a tool for a person to smoke the conventional cigarettes. Therefore, it is found that e-cigarettes are not an alternative or an aid to stop smoking. Instead, they have acted as an effective drive that forces or influences the e-cigarette smokers or the vapers to get into conventional smoking. So this reinforces the unhealthy use of nicotine and it has hampered or affected all the efforts that has been taken so far by the government against the nicotine use and the tobacco control efforts in India. Therefore, the electronic cigarettes have also acted as a hindrance in achieving the targets under Sustainable Development Goals. If you see, India has certain targets under National Monitoring Framework for Prevention and Control of Non-Communicable Diseases. And it also has certain targets under National Health Policy 2017. But usage of e-cigarettes is not helping India to achieve these targets under these policies. Now, let us see the Sustainable Development Goal number 3. It deals with good health and well-being. And here, the target has to be achieved by the year 2030. Under this goal number 3, there is a target which is called as target 3.5, where every nation should strengthen the prevention and treatment of substance abuse, which includes narcotic drug abuse and also the harmful use of alcohol. Also, this Sustainable Development Goal framework states that education on the risks of tobacco is necessary to achieve the target of reducing the premature deaths due to incommunicable diseases by one-third by the year 2030. So if non-communicable diseases and related deaths have to be controlled, then there shall be prohibition on the usage of e-cigarettes. Then let us see the National Health Policy 2017. Under this, there is a target of achieving relative reduction in the prevalence of tobacco use. That is, the tobacco use shall be reduced by 15% by the year 2020 and 30% by the year 2025. From the 2017 tobacco use levels. But we see that the e-cigarettes drive people towards tobacco consumption. So electronic cigarettes or the e-cigarettes acts as a hindrance against all these efforts of the government. So overall, we can say that the use of electronic drugs is detrimental to the public health. That is, it affects the public health. And therefore, the state shall prohibit the consumption or the use of intoxicating drugs that are injurious to health in order to improve the public health in India. But there is one exception. Certain drugs can be used for medicinal purposes. This is mentioned in Article 47 of Indian Constitution, which is nothing but the directive principles of state policy. This article is one of the directive principles of state policy under the Indian Constitution. So, as per Article 47, and all the reasons that we have discussed so far, the Union Cabinet has decided to prohibit the e-cigarettes or the electronic nicotine delivery systems and its forms such as heat-not-burn products, e-hookah and other such devices. Now, let us see some of the initiatives taken by the central government and the state governments with respect to e-cigarettes. See, e-cigarettes is banned in around 16 states and in one union territory. In the year 2018, the central government has sent an advisory to all the states to consider banning e-cigarettes. And recently, the union government, that is the central government, has thought of bringing an ordinance to deal with this matter immediately, since both the houses of the parliament is not in session now. That is the reason why an ordinance will be promulgated. know that an ordinance will be promulgated by the president based on Article 123 of Indian Constitution. The draft ordinance has been examined by the group of ministers as per the directions from the office of the Prime Minister. The Union Health Ministry, that is the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, has also proposed for a prohibition of electronic cigarettes. So soon the ordinance will be promulgated by the president, and once promulgated, the e-cigarettes will be banned for a period till a law is made by the parliament in the next session. And this is as per the procedure under Article 123 of Indian Constitution. So whatever ordinance that is promulgated under Article 123 will have the same force and effect as an act of parliament. And know that such an ordinance will cease to operate, that is, it will not be valid after 6 weeks once the parliament reassembles. Now, let us see the status of nicotine in India under some regulations and also the scientific opinion of the Indian Council of Medical Research and World Health Organization. See, in India, the use of nicotine as an ingredient in a food item is prohibited. So, this prohibition is under the Food Safety and Standards Prohibition and Restrictions on Sales Regulation 2011, and this regulation is as per the Food Safety and Standards Act of 2006. And nicotine and nicotine sulfate are listed as hazardous chemicals under Environment Protection Act of 1986, and they are listed as hazardous chemicals in the Manufacture, Storage and Import of Hazardous Chemical Rules 1989. See, the exact statement that is given by the Indian Council of Medical Research is that based on the currently available scientific data from multiple streams of research, the council recommends complete prohibition on e-cigarettes in India in the greater interest of protecting public health. So this is the statement that has been given by the Indian Council of Medical Research. According to the news article, even the World Health Organization has asked the member nations to take appropriate steps against e-cigarettes. Even the World Health Organization states that e-cigarettes cannot be called as a cessation aid. Here, cessation aid means something that will eventually lead to quit smoking. But we saw that electronic cigarettes reinforce smoking, and therefore they cannot be considered as a cessation aid. So in this news article, we have seen what is meant by e-cigarettes. Then we have seen what are the reasons behind the move of the Union government, that is the central government, to bring an ordinance for the prohibition of e-cigarettes. And we also saw some of the steps taken by the government to deal with the problem of e-cigarettes. Then we saw the health effects of these e-cigarettes and the scientific opinion of these e-cigarettes at the end. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article discusses about International Migrant Stock 2019, which is released by the Population Division of the Department of Economic and Social Affairs of the United Nations. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Before seeing the news article, first let us see the main organs of UN, which are also called the principal organs of United Nations. The principal organs of United Nations are General Assembly, then we have the Security Council, then Economic and Social Council, then Trusteeship Council, then International Court of Justice, and finally we have the UN Secretariat. There are many offices and departments under this UN Secretariat, and they have certain set of actions and responsibilities. One such department is the Department of Economic and Social Affairs. And under this department, there are 10 divisions. One such department is the Population Division. Now, let us see in brief about this Department of Economic and Social Affairs, which comes under UN Secretariat. See, the main purpose of United Nations is to achieve international cooperation in many areas, like in terms of economy, in terms of social development, and also in terms of environment. So under many areas, there are global policies which has been developed by the United Nations, and the member nations of United Nations have the responsibility to turn these global policies into national actions. So this Department of Economic and Social Affairs acts as an important interface between the global policies in the economic, social and environmental spheres and the national actions. Interface is nothing but a meeting point where the United Nations and the member nations can sit and work together on transforming the global policies into national actions. So this Department of Economic and Social Affairs works in three main interlinked areas. One, this department compiles, generates and analyzes a wide range of economic, social and environmental data and information, and this information will be used by the member nations of United Nations. The next area where this department will play a key role is that it will act as a facilitator. That is, it will facilitate the negotiations of the member states in many intergovernmental bodies of United Nations. So, based on this, the course of action will be taken to address the ongoing and the emerging global challenges. The next area where this department plays a key role is that it acts as an advisor. It advises the governments which are interested in translating the policy frameworks which has been developed by the United Nations into programs at the country level. So, this department will provide technical assistance in order to build the national capacities of the member nations. So, one role is that it will create the data and information. The second role is that it will facilitate the negotiations between the member nations and United Nations. And the third role is that it will act as an advisor for the member nations, that is the national governments. So, under this department, there are 10 divisions. One such division is the population division. Now, let us see in brief about the population division. See, this division was established to serve as a secretariat for the then Population Commission, which was created in the year 1946. Later, this became into the Population Division. The main work of this Population Division is that it will study the population dynamics and it will also monitor the demographic trends and the policies that are present worldwide. This division will provide timely and accessible population data. Then it will also provide analysis of the population trends and the development outcomes of the member nations of United Nations. So, the main aim of this division, or we can tell the main objective of this division, is to provide extensive support on population and development issues to the United Nations General Assembly. Then it also provides support to the Economic and Social Council and also to the Commission on Population and Development. So, the ultimate objective of this population division is that it will help in strengthening the capacity of the member states or the member nations so that the nations can monitor their population trends and in order to address their emerging population issues. Now, let us see the main activities of the population division. The first main activity is the demographic analysis, that is the analysis of the population. So, this division will analyze the fertility and family planning of the member states. Then the population policies which the member nations have taken, and also it will do analysis on the migration patterns, and it will also conduct population studies on population and development, then population estimates and projections, then it will also conduct studies on mortality. So, we saw that this population division conducts analysis on migration. So, this department analyzes the data on migration, which is collected by the UN Statistics Division. And know that this statistic division is yet another division under the Department of Economic and Social Affairs. So, the statistics division will collect the data on migration, and the population division will analyze the data on migration, and this population division will release the international migrant stock. So, this international migrant stock will provide estimate of the total number of international migrants who are present in a given country at a particular point of time. It provides the latest estimates of the number of the international migrants by age, sex and origin for all the countries and areas of the world. And these estimates are based on the official national statistics, which contains data on foreign-born population or the foreign population. This data is important because it is required for understanding the role of migrants and migration in any country's development. Here, the term international migrant means any person who changes his or her country of usual residence. That is, they move from one country to another. And the term stock means the total number of international migrants who are present in a given country at a particular point of time. So, this data is based on the national statistics on the country of birth or based on the country of citizenship. Know that in India, census is conducted once in 10 years, and the responsibility of conducting this census lies with the Office of the Registrar General and Census Commissioner, India, which comes under the Ministry of Home Affairs, Government of India. But this data of collecting census is not uniform across all the member nations of United Nations. And also each nations have a different system of coining the migrants. So in order to improve the statistics and the systems, the United Nations came up with a definition of international migrant, which is any person who changes his or her country of usual residence. And the United Nations also differentiated or distinguished between short-term migrants and long-term migrants. Short-term migrants are those migrants who change their country of usual residence for at least 3 months, but less than a year. That is between 3 months and 1 year. And long-term migrants are those who change their country of usual residence at least for 1 year. But if you see, all the countries have not adopted such a definition. And still there are countries which use different criteria to identify the international migrants. So this population division has its own methodologies to arrive at the estimates of migration patterns. Now let us see the outcomes of this International Migrant Stock 2019. We saw that it provides the latest estimates of the number of international migrants by age, sex and origin. Now let us focus based on the origin. We saw the definition for the term international migrant. It is any person who changes his or her country of usual residence. So they move from one country to another. The country from where they move is the country of origin, and the country to where they arrive is the country of destination. Say if a person is moving from India to US, India is the country of origin and US is the country of destination. So these countries can also be called as host countries. Now in this report, it has mentioned the largest hosts of migrants continent-wise and country-wise. First, let us see continent-wise data. This report tells that Europe continent has the largest hosts of migrants, which is 82 million. This is followed by Northern America, which is hosting 59 million. And this is followed by Northern Africa and Western Asia, which is hosting 49 million migrants. And in terms of country-wise data, USA has the most number of migrants, which is 51 million. This is followed by Germany and Saudi Arabia, who host 13 million migrant population each. And this data is followed by Russia, which hosts 12 million migrant population. Now let us see the largest countries of origin of the migrants. It is India. So from India, at least 18 million people, that is 1.8 crore people, have migrated from India to other foreign nations. And it is followed by Mexico, where 12 million people have migrated from Mexico, followed by China. 11 million people have migrated from China, and this is followed by Russia, where 10 million people have migrated from Russia to other nations. And then we have Syria, where 8 million people have migrated from Syria to other nations. Though huge population migrate from India, Mexico, China, Russia every year to other nations, only in the past few years a lot of population of Syria has migrated from Syria to other nations, because this is due to the war that is happening in Syria. So we can call this as a forced displacement as well, because it is happening due to the war. This report has also recorded that there is an increase in forced displacements across international borders. So totally, as of 2019, at least 272 million people have migrated from one nation to other nation. So there are 272 million international migrants. And when compared with 2010 data, it is at least 51 million more. And from this data, we can see that India is the largest country of origin where the migrants move from India to other nations. And in terms of destination, US is the largest country which receives the largest number of migrants. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the recently published information on malnutrition in India. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. This news article talks about an initiative that was launched with the support of the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This initiative is called as the India State Level Disease Burden Initiative. See, this initiative was launched in October 2015, that is before 4 years. It is a collaboration between the Indian Council of Medical Research, then the Public Health Foundation of India, then the Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation. This collaboration also includes senior experts and stakeholders from about 100 institutions across India currently. It is this initiative that has published the first comprehensive estimates of disease burden due to child and maternal malnutrition. And They have also published the trends of child and maternal malnutrition in every state of India from the year 1990 till the year 2017. And this was published in the journal The Lancet Child and Adolescent Health. Before entering into the findings of the published article, we will see the definition of deaths and disability adjusted life years, which is used to measure the disease burden. This is in short called as DALYS, or we can tell it DALYS. DALY refers to the sum of the years of healthy life which is lost due to disability and years of life lost due to premature mortality. A child dying at the age of 3 due to diarrhea because of malnutrition is an example of premature mortality. So that particular child has lost 60 to 70 years of life due to malnutrition. The more the DALY, poorer is the situation of health and more disease burden. And lesser the DALY, it means less disease burden and better state of health. And DALY will be very minimum or near zero if all people live to an advanced age free from disease and disability. Here the word disability does not refer to the physical disability, but it reflects the severity of the disease. They call it as disability weight, that is used for the calculation of DALYS on a scale from 0 to 1. Here 0 corresponds to perfect health and 1 corresponds to equivalent to death. This analysis has been done as a part of the Global Burden of Diseases, Injuries and Risk Factors study of 2017. Now, let us see some of the findings published as a part of the study related to child malnutrition. One is that India has substantially improved in reducing under 5 child mortality due to malnutrition when we compare the situation of 2017 with the situation that was there in the year 1990. However, malnutrition was a predominant risk factor for death in children who are younger than 5 years of age in every state of India in the year 2017, which accounted for 68.2%. That is, 68.2% of children who have died before attaining the age of 5 is because of malnutrition. And malnutrition is the leading risk factor for disease burden for all ages in most of these states. The study states that malnutrition continues to be the leading risk factor for disease burden in India. Also, the malnutrition trends up to the year 2017 indicate that India will require substantially higher rates of improvement in most of these states in order to achieve the 2022 Indian goals and the 2030 global targets. Here, 2022 Indian goals means the goals that are set up under the National Nutrition Mission. And the 2030 global targets here refer to the Sustainable Development Goal targets. If you remember, during 16th September Hindu News Analysis, we discussed about Poshan Abhiyan, which is also called the National Nutrition Mission. And we saw set of targets which has to be met under this National Nutrition Mission. India aims to reduce stunting by 2% every year till the year 2022. Then India has also targeted to reduce undernutrition by 2% every year. Then it has also planned to reduce anemia among young children, women and adolescent girls by 3% every year. So our news article on 16 September was regarding anemia. And then there is also target to reduce low birth weight every year by 2% by India. If you see here, the stunting was around 38.4% in 2015-16, and the target is that to reduce stunting to 25% by the year 2022. The article that was published in the journal has stated that there is also a wide variation in the malnutrition status among the states. Some states are relatively better and some are relatively poorer. The better states are the states such as Sikkim, Maharashtra, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. If you see the news article, you can find in the image the disability adjusted life years rate attributable to malnutrition in children younger than 5 years of age. It is low for the better states and high for the relatively poorer states. The states where malnutrition has become a huge burden for deaths in children are the states of Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and Assam. Now let us see some of the malnutrition indicators. They are undernourishment, child wasting, child stunting, child mortality and low birth weight. And here children refers to those individuals who are less than 5 years of age. Now the term undernourishment refers to the share of the population that is undernourished, which means their calorie intake of food is quite insufficient. Usually the energy that we derive from the food is measured in terms of calories. That's why caloric intake is mentioned. Next, the term child wasting, it refers to those children who have low weight for their height. It is also called as child underweight. It reflects acute or serious undernutrition. It is also called as low weight for height. The next term is child stunting. It refers to the share of children who have low height for their age. Here, India's performance is not satisfactory in terms of low birth weight. The term low birth weight refers to the situation where the baby is born with the weight less than 2500 grams, that is 2.5 kilograms. Low birth weight is the biggest contributor to child mortality in India, and it is also the largest contributor for deaths and disability adjusted life years. And the rate of decline in low birth weight is among the lowest. So this is what has been highlighted in the report and also in the news article. Therefore, the need of the hour is policy attention for child wasting. Now, let us see some of the major determinants for malnutrition. One is the provision of clean drinking water. Intake of clean drinking water is very important for proper nutrition, and the children will be safe from water-related diseases if they consume clean drinking water. The next determinant is there should not be any open defecation, because open defecation will lead to gastrointestinal problems, and this will ultimately affect the body utilization of the food that is being consumed by the children. Also, open defecation contributes to the incidence of diarrhea and the spread of intestinal parasites, which cause malnutrition. These intestinal parasites are roundworms, whipworms, hookworms, etc. So all these intestinal parasites are transmitted through the contaminated soil in areas where open defecation is practiced. Know that hookworm is a major cause of anemia in pregnant women, which leads to malnourished and underweight babies. So improving the nutrition status of women through education is quite necessary. Also, the nutrition status is quite important for the mothers, as it will have an effect on the fetus and the newborn child. Apart from this, food security and nutritional security should also be there for the vulnerable families. This is because the vulnerable families are the most affected, and these families have the highest proportion of children who are suffering from malnutrition. Then the news article also talks about child overweight. As of now, around 11.5% of children who are aged between 2 and 4 years are overweight. So the term overweight refers to having body mass index above the prescribed levels. Just know that body mass index is a measure of body fat based on the height and weight that applies to adult men and women. The report that is published in the journal states that child overweight is increasing rapidly across all states of India. Overweight children have the risk of having high blood pressure and high cholesterol, and both these are the risk factors for cardiovascular diseases. Apart from this, those children who are overweight may also develop breathing problems such as asthma, then they may also be affected by joint problems, then fatty liver disease and other such similar diseases. With this, we come to the end of this news article. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about Chennai-Bengaluru Industrial Corridor. The news is that the central government has decided to extend the Chennai-Bengaluru Industrial Corridor till Kochi, which is located in the state of Kerala. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Before seeing the news article, first let us see about industrial corridors, then the planned or proposed industrial corridors in India, then about the administrative body which manages these industrial corridors. Then we'll be seeing the news article. See, industrial corridors recognize the interdependence of various sectors of the economy. Now take a classic example of ketchup, that is the tomato ketchup. Here producing the tomato belongs to agri sector, and whatever tomato that has been produced will move to the industry, that is the food processing industry. This industry will come under the manufacturing sector, and whatever tomato ketchup that has been manufactured has to be shipped to different places from the place where it is manufactured. So this will be done through logistics, and this logistics will come under the service sector. Now, by developing the industrial corridor, the government plans to develop all the sectors of the economy. So there will be interdependence of various sectors of the economy, and these industrial corridors will offer effective integration between the industry and the infrastructure, which will lead to overall economic and social development in India. So these industrial corridors will have world-class infrastructure such as high-speed transportation networks, like the road network, rail network, then there will also be ports with the state-of-art cargo handling equipments that is being used for shipping. Then modern airports have also been planned. Then special economic regions, industrial areas have also been planned. Then there will also be logistic parks and transshipment hubs. So we can see that there is an effective integration between the industry and infrastructure, and all the sectors of the economy will be interdependent. So the main focus of these industrial corridors is to provide a boost to industrialization and also planned urbanization. When we tell planned urbanization, people will settle in those places when an industry starts to develop. So a population will be based on that particular industry, which is called as planned urbanization. So all the urban facilities will also be planned in advance so that there is a planned infrastructure in place. So we can see that manufacturing is the key economic driver in each of these projects. So there is a special focus on manufacturing throughout these corridors which have been planned. So each corridor will pass through many cities. We can call them as industrial cities or nodes. So these cities will be present all along the corridors. As of now, 5 corridors have been planned or proposed in India. First, let us see Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor. See, this Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor project was approved by the central government in the year 2007, but the scheme was launched in September 2011. When this particular project was launched, it aimed to create a world-class infrastructure with reduced logistics costs. And new cities have been planned to come up in the states through which this corridor passes. The states are Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat and Maharashtra. These cities will be smart, sustainable industrial cities. Next is the Amritsar-Kolkata Industrial Corridor. This corridor will cover the states of Punjab, Haryana, Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand and West Bengal. Next is the Bengaluru-Mumbai Industrial Corridor. It will cover the states of Karnataka and Maharashtra. Next we have Chennai-Bengaluru Corridor, which is in news today. This corridor initially planned to cover the states of Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka, and now Kerala has also been included. So this is the news. And finally, we have East Coast Economic Corridor, which will cover the states of West Bengal, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. The phase one of this particular East Coast Economic Corridor is the Vizag-Chennai Industrial Corridor. So first, an industrial corridor from the city of Visakhapatnam, which is located in the state of Andhra Pradesh, will be connected with Chennai, which is located in Tamil Nadu. In order to coordinate and develop all the industrial corridor projects, including the Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, the government of India came up with a plan. So initially, there was Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor Project Implementation Trust Fund. In 2016, this particular entity was redesignated as National Industrial Corridor Development and Implementation Trust, in short NICDIT. So from 2016, this NICDIT is acting as an apex body overseeing the development of all the industrial corridors that have been planned in India. And this NICDIT is under the administrative control of Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, in short DPIIT. And this department comes under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So as of now, there are 5 corridors which come under the administrative control of NICDIT, and whatever corridors that will come in the future will also function under the administrative control of NICDIT. Know that an apex monitoring authority has been set up to periodically review the activities of this NICDIT and the progress of the industrial corridor projects. The chairperson of this particular authority is the Union Finance Minister. The ministers who are in charge of certain ministries, like the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, then the Ministry of Railways, then the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, then the Ministry of Shipping. Apart from these ministers who are in charge of these ministries, the Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog is also a member of this apex monitoring authority. Apart from this, the chief ministers of the states who are concerned with a particular industrial corridor will also be members of the apex monitoring authority. So this authority will periodically review the activities of NICDIT and the progress of the projects. We saw that in every corridor there will be many industrial cities or nodes which will be set up. Each industrial city or node along these industrial corridors has been planned to be implemented by a special purpose vehicle. So this special purpose vehicle will be in the form of a company which is set up under the Companies Act. So this special purpose vehicle will act as a joint venture between the Government of India, which is represented through NICDIT, and the respective state governments. And the progress of whatever project under these industrial corridors will be regularly monitored by the Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade. Now let us come to the news article. The news article says that National Industrial Corridor Development and Implementation Trust, that is the NICDIT, has conveyed the intention of the central government to Kerala state government. The intention or the decision of the central government is that Chennai-Bengaluru Industrial Corridor will be extended to Kochi, which is located in Kerala. We saw that till now, Chennai-Bengaluru Industrial Corridor will cover the states of Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. Now, after this announcement, it will also cover the state of Kerala. So, Kerala is also a part of this Chennai-Bengaluru Industrial Corridor. Maybe in the future, the name of this industrial corridor might also be changed. The news article also tells that two integrated manufacturing clusters would be developed. One cluster will be at Salem, which is located in Tamil Nadu, and the second cluster will be located at Palakkad in the state of Kerala. This news article tells that this industrial corridor will create huge employment opportunities and it will initiate a trend of reverse migration. Now, if you see the migration pattern in India, it is mostly from the rural to the urban areas, where the people who are living in the rural areas go in search of employment and better life to the urban areas. Now, when they come to know that there is better employment opportunities in the rural areas or near the areas where they reside, they will get a thought to go back to their native and work there only. So, this pattern is called the reverse migration. So, back from the urban areas to the rural areas, or you can even tell them as semi-urban areas. So there will be enough economic opportunities that will be created once the industrial corridor is set up. The news article is also telling that the young manpower in the state of Kerala will be taking up various manufacturing activities, including high-end engineering work, which will be offered by the corridor within Kerala. So this project is expected to generate more employment and this will lead to overall economic growth of Kerala. We saw that two manufacturing clusters have been planned. These clusters would comprise electronics, food processing, then agro-based units, and it will also have IT, that is the information technology industries, and also the traditional industries. And this is expected to create around 10,000 jobs as mentioned in the news article. So this is all about this news article. We saw what is meant by industrial corridor, then the planned industrial corridors in India, then about National Industrial Corridor Development and Implementation Trust, and finally about the news. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. See the first question, consider the following statements. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements. The first statement tells that at present polio virus is endemic to Pakistan, Somalia and Bangladesh. We saw during our discussion that at present polio virus is endemic only to two nations, which are the countries of Pakistan and Afghanistan. It is not Somalia and Bangladesh. So the first statement goes wrong. The second statement tells that India was declared polio free in 2010. This statement is also wrong. During our discussion, we saw that India was declared polio free by the World Health Organization in the year 2014. Now this question has asked you to choose the correct statements. Since both the statements are wrong, the correct answer is option D, neither one nor two. Moving on to the next question, consider the following pairs. They have given certain articles of Indian Constitution and the subjects that deal with that particular article. So you have to choose the correctly matched pairs. The first pair is Article 143, Power of President to Consult Supreme Court. This pair is correct. Article 143 discusses about the power of President to consult Supreme Court. During our discussion today, we saw Article 123, and that article deals with the power of President to promulgate an ordinance when the Parliament is not in session and when the matter requires immediate action. Let us see the second pair now, Article 47. The subject given is state to prohibit intoxicating drugs which are injurious to health. We saw this article as a part of our discussion about e-cigarettes today, and we also saw that Article 47 comes under the directive principles of state policy. So all those articles from numbers 36 to 51 come under directive principles of state policy under Part 4 of Indian Constitution. Now coming to this Article 47, this article mentions that the state shall take three things as a part of its primary duties. The first is raising the level of nutrition. And the second is raising the standard of living of its people, that is the people of India. And third, it speaks about the improvement of public health. Then it also mentions that the state shall endeavor to bring prohibition of the consumption of intoxicating drinks and drugs which are injurious to health. So this pair is also correct. Let us see the third pair now, Article 44, and the subject given is Uniform Civil Code. This pair is also correct. Article 44 states that the state shall endeavor to secure for the citizens a uniform civil code throughout the territory of India. And this article also comes under the directive principles of state policy under part 4 of Indian Constitution. We discussed this Article 44 during a recent analysis of Hindu on 14th of September. That day also we saw why Portuguese civil code is mentioned as a shining example of a civil code by the Supreme Court. This civil code is applicable in the state of Goa, but know that India is not having any uniform civil code as on date. This question has asked you to choose the correct pairs. Since all the three pairs are correct, the correct answer is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Moving on to the next question, the question is the International Migrant Stock 2019 has been published by which of the following? Here the correct answer is Population Division of UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs. So the correct answer is option A, Population Division of UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs. And this UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs, in short UN DESA, comes under UN Secretariat. And this department has 10 divisions. One out of the 10 is the Population Division, which releases the International Migrant Stock 2019. Moving on to the next question, consider the following statements. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements. The first statement, it tells that low birth weight, which is an indicator of malnutrition, denotes a condition in which babies are born weighing less than 1500 grams. This statement is wrong. Today during our discussion, we saw that it was 2500 grams and not 1500 grams. So it is 2500 grams or 2.5 kg. We also saw about low birth weight. During our discussion, low birth weight is the biggest contributor to child mortality in India, and it is also the largest contributor for deaths and disability adjusted life years. So this statement is wrong. Moving on to the second statement, the statement tells that child wasting refers to a condition where the child has less weight to his or her height. See here, this statement is correct. Just remember a trick. Wasting starts with the alphabet W and weight also starts with the alphabet W. So child wasting is a condition where the child has less weight, WW. Child stunting refers to low height for their age, that is it reflects the chronic or long-term undernutrition. Whereas we saw that child wasting relates to a condition where the child has less weight to his or her height. So it reflects the acute or serious or intense undernutrition. So this statement is correct. The question has asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option B, 2 only, since the first statement was wrong. Moving on to the next question, the question is, consider the following statements. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements. The first statement tells that National Industrial Corridor Development and Implementation Trust is the apex body to oversee integrated development of all industrial corridors across India. This statement is correct. As of now, this administrative body, that is the National Industrial Corridor Development and Implementation Trust, will implement all the 5 proposed industrial corridors, and this entity functions under the Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, which comes under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Now let us see the second statement. It tells that it functions under the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, but we just now saw that it functions under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So the second statement is wrong. The question has asked you to choose the correct statements. The correct answer is option A, 1 only. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.